systems. You know, when our Dutch ancestors arrived over here in the 17th century, they used a patronymic naming system. It was kind of a Germanic, medieval type system, which they still used. And in that system, there was no surname for the family. A man's last name came from his father's first name. So for example, Jan, son of Peter, was Jan Peters. But if he named his son Peter after his father, then his son would be Peter Jans or Peter Jansen. So the last name changed with every generation. Mm-hmm. And the names could be based on also on their nickname instead of their first name. The Dutch had a different way of making nicknames than the English. The English nicknames are customarily made from the first part of the name. For example, Christopher, the nickname is Chris. Well, in Dutch, it's taken from the latter part of the name. So in Dutch, the name for Christopher is Stoffer. That's the nickname. And for Matthew, in English, it's Matt. But the Dutch for Matthias is Tice. And so a man could have the nickname Tice, and his son might have the last name Tyson. So a man who had four sons, each of the sons would have the same last name, but the first cousins, the next generation, would all have different names based on their father's name. So you couldn't tell that they were cousins by their last name, nor could you tell that other people in the town that had the same last name as them were not related at all. And this drove the English crazy. So the English demanded that the Dutch take non-changing last names. So almost all the van-type names that you hear are actually American names that Dutch families assumed in America at the demand of the English. And they indicate where the family came from in Holland. Not everybody took that kind of name. Some, in fact, just froze their patronymic name, so it stayed the same from generation to generation. And some took names based on their trade. But the Vans were all names that were assumed here because the English demanded it. Now, a little later when we... Thank you.
line road, known as the oldest continuously used road in the entire United States of America, running from the Delaware Water Gap currently to Kingston, New York. Kingston was the former capital of New York, used to be called the Sopus back in the day. When you wanted to travel to the New Jersey frontier along the Delaware, if you lived down here in New York City, you would go up the Hudson, up to Kingston, and take the pass between the mountains, down to Port Jervis, and down along the Old Mine Road. This is currently Route 209 in New York. This is also the path of the D&H Canal. All the coal from Pennsylvania ran from here to the Hudson, ironically, to go back down the Hudson to Philadelphia, back to the state of Pennsylvania. To travel in those days, this was such thick woodland, you would have to go up the river, and you followed a natural path. That natural path was the way the animals originally went. Way, you know, for many years, the Indians would follow the animals down the trail. The animals were food, the Indians followed the food, and the road became more and more traveled, so a small animal path ended up becoming a major trail and basically a major roadway, not like the roadways of today where you're like just big wide roads with cars on it, but it was a major thoroughfare. It was the easiest place to traverse was between the passes and along the river. Of course, you had water and everything else along the way. Just recently, I discovered that this path is probably well worn by our friend the mastodon here, because the Paleo Indians were here probably 10,000 BC in this area, so it was inhabited for quite a long time. Now, what made the road be called the Old Mine Road is back in the day, the Indians had some copper ornamentation, copper jewelry. It wasn't used for money like we would use it today, but it was more ornamental. The Dutch discovered that the Indians had this copper. And of course, they became very intrigued by it because copper was, you know, was worth a lot. Copper was a big thing. So what did it look like in its raw form would be a copper ore, and what you see, the green is the malachite. That's part of the ore, and the copper is in between. And if you notice, copper, people who had copper jewelry make your skin turn green or whatever, that's because of the malachite. And I don't know exactly how they managed to smelt this. Originally, I think it was done by accident, but this would be crushed up and heated and to burn off and get the copper out, and this is what it would look like up close, solid copper ore. And of course, as most people know it, nice and shiny copper and little nuggets. But as it turned out, the mine itself did not really have a lot of richness in it, but people, I guess, they did explore it and play around with the fact that they might get something out of it, and they didn't really. The fact that they say they improved the road for the copper, they would do that once they knew they had a rich amount of copper, but they never really proved they did. But still, the road became it's a thoroughfare for travelers. It became part of a military trail further up on towards Walpack and the area where it met with 206. It's just a very important route over the years. And parts of it today are original, I would say, as close as they were back then, and some are just deviated from the original path.
In the very early days, in the very early part of the 1700s, there was no church. And the people keenly felt the lack of good Christian teaching, especially for their children. And so they sent to Holland for a minister, and they got Theodor Frelinghuysen. And he came with his brother-in-law named Schurman. And Schurman was a teacher in the school. So there was a church and a school. The people, most of them, came here from up around Albany. And that was because this area had been a continuously occupied Indian settlement for over 7,000 years. It was the crossing of the North and the South Branch rivers and two main Indian trails right at this point. So it was a trading center and a permanent settlement for a long time. And the Dutch, who, different from the English in a way, were more inclined to fur trading rather than farming it early on. And so they settled up in Albany to do fur trading, and some of these fur traders came down here to trade with these Indians in this permanent settlement. And they bought a little bit of land from the Indians right at that point where the church was, and they established a trading post about 1680. And so it was their influence, as they came from Albany, their influence drew other settlers from Albany when the land became available. Had the American Revolution, at that time it became popular among the Dutch to anglicize their names. And this took a lot of different forms. Sometimes if they had a name that was based on their trade, like Schmidt, they became Smith. Colonel Frelinghuysen, which is a well-known Dutch name, he was called Frelinghuis. A lot of the Van names dropped the Van. The Van Covenhoven family, a large number of them, just assumed the name Conover. So if you see a Conover, that goes back to Van Covenhoven. And so those are some of the things that you need to know if you're ever going to do any family history of a Dutch family. It becomes difficult.
at the point where the McDay Trail runs into the start of the Hogback Ridge Trail. And as we look out to our left and follow the ridgeline, we're pointing directly at the putative location of Fort Hinshaw, overlooking the Delaware River, overlooking the Bushkill Creek, approximately a quarter mile off of the Delaware. Very high strategic vantage point with clear sight lines in almost every direction. Very, very good military choice, and it was on a parcel of land that was actually deeded to none other than Johannes Conrad Weiser, colonel of the 1st Battalion of the Pennsylvania Militia, to whom the good captain reported. So we know that the fort was definitely on that plot of land, and that spot over there represents our best attempt to locate it thus far. Flat plateau overlooks the Bushkill Creek to the left, overlooks the Delaware River straight in front of us. This is the area that was first described by Commissary General of the Muster, James Young, back in 1756 when he visited the fort. He noted its location as 10 miles upriver from the fort further south, which would have been Fort Depew, and noted that it was on the banks of a large creek. So we're going to the spot, which is at exactly 1/4 mile off of the Delaware. And this is the only flat plateau that you've got in this entire area of strategic value, of course, with direct roadway connections to the major road of the day, the Hogback Trail on this side, and on the other side, a connection to the ferry crossing. Right here is a rather unusual cemetery. Unusual to the degree that there were a total of 48 unmarked graves. By unmarked, I'm referring to upright field stones with no inscriptions, no dates, no names. We have a few in the area with inscriptions, a total of five surnames. In those, we have the inscriptions that correspond to the surnames of Vanetta, Hinshaw, and Courtright, who would have been the sergeant for the fort.
It.
And so there's the Bushkill Creek. Right there you can see the Delaware River. So this was a highly strategic location. Unbelievable vantage point. What you're looking at is a patch of vinca minor. Some people call it myrtle. It was a plant that was favored by the Dutch, I guess primarily because it tended to blossom around Easter time. And archaeologists have been known to use this plant as an indicator of old home sites. So, the fact that we are in an area in the middle of a forest, and here you've got this one patch of vinca, is strongly indicative that you had a habitation of some type here at this very spot. And this is where I believe the fort was actually at.
My name's Don Kent. I've lived here since, well, the house has been in the family since 1933. Before that, it was owned by a Dumont family who had been here many years. As a matter of fact, there was this picture of the house with a Dumont tavern over the front window. There's a study been made by government people, and I understand you have it. It's on the email I got it. But the house was built apparently, according to the previous town historian, about 1685, maybe a year or two before that, but probably not after that. So the house is roughly, what now, 330 years old. These two rooms were built first. That other room was added probably 10 or 15 years later, and that was just a window that was cut down to make that door in here. That's why that door is so much shorter than the others. But these are all stone walls between this room and the other room, and stone walls, of course, outside. Peter Stuyvesant at one time owned this property. In 1663, they had surveyed all the properties that were here. Before that, there were just squatters, you know. They surveyed all the properties and a lot of the lands to either friends of his or to the people who lived here already. And he took best property right in the middle of town for himself. So at one time, yes, he owned this property and the property next door, probably next door to that too. Several lots along here. They were all separated into lots.